This is going to be the fastest message you've ever heard in your life. Turn to the book of Luke real quick, quickly. God gave me a prophecy back a few days ago, and Olivia typed it up for me when she got back from Mexico. And I'll read its promise to you, and then we'll get into the message. It says, "My children, listen to my prophet and teacher. He speaks the truth when he tells you that through sincere prayer, you lose a series of powerful, earth-shattering dynamics. You can bind and loose on earth. This principle works to the benefit of my people. The authority to enforce Christ's victory over Satan was delegated to the church in Matthew 16:18-19. Where it says, "And I say unto thee, thou art Peter, and upon this rock I will build my church, and the gates of hell shall not prevail against it. And I will give unto thee keys of the kingdom, and whatsoever thou shalt bind on earth shall be bound in heaven, whatsoever thou shalt loose on earth shall be loosed in heaven." You know that Satan has already been condemned in Hebrews 2:14, and his works destroyed in 1 John 3:8. Satan and his demons have to ask God for permission to act. Remember when the demons begged to be cast into pigs? Satan will do all to frighten and prevent us from using our weapons of warfare. Satan may tempt you as a Christian. He may accuse you. He will try to sift you, to wrestle with you. But as long as you remain strong in Christ Jesus, he can never destroy you. God's word loudly and clearly proclaims that greater is he that is in you than he that is in the world. Remember the words of your Messiah. These signs shall follow them that believe in my name. They shall cast out demons. They will speak with new tongues. They will take up serpents, and if they drink anything deadly, it will by no means hurt them. They will lay hands on the sick, they will recover." Mark 16, verses 17 and 18. And there's about 25 copies there for those that care to have those in their possession. Open up your Bible very quickly to Luke. I gotta really move along. Luke 24. Look at the 14th verse, beginning with the 14th verse. I'm going to read it very, very quickly. The point I'm trying to get across today is that we can become blinded to the obvious. We live in a world of pressure. We live in a world of pain and suffering. Christ made it very, very clear that this world was never going to be a rose garden. He never promised us that. He said, "I will be with you. I will give you hope and promise for the future." But he said, while you're in this world, you will have tribulation. You will have trials. Amen. So what we see in the passage we're about to read is the men that were involved in this scenario were blinded to Jesus' presence, probably because of their own despair. We can be so overwhelmed, so taken aback, that we cannot see the most obvious thing that God has for us, and that is the promises of his kingdom life coming from his kingdom word. You know, his word is kingdom. It's going to be, it says, "Heaven and earth will pass away, but my word will never pass away." We'll have his word even in glory. Let me read it very quickly. Look at the 14th verse with me. You all know the story very, very well. All right? We have it?
Amen.
Let's start with the 13th verse. "Now behold, two of them were traveling the same way, traveling the same day to a village called Emmaus, which was 7 miles from Jerusalem." Short distance from what had just taken place. The death and the burial, and now the resurrection of Jesus Christ. People said, well, where was he when he was in the tomb? His body was in the tomb, but where was he? Well, he was about doing his Father's business. Not only went into the bowels of the earth and preached to the prisoners in Hades, but he was also communicating with his disciples. Verse 14, and they talked together of all the things which had happened. And so it was while they conversed and reasoned that Jesus himself drew near and went with them. But their eyes were restrained so that they did not know him. And he said to them, what kind of conversation is this that you have with one another as you walk and are sad? They didn't get the reason of Jesus' death. They still did not understand it. Then the one whose name was Cleopas answered and said to him, are you the only stranger in Jerusalem? And have you not known the things which happened there in these days? And he said to them, what things? So they said to him, the things concerning Jesus of Nazareth, who was a prophet, mighty in deed and word before God and all the people. And how the chief priests and our rulers delivered him to be condemned to death and crucified him. But we were, here's the problem, but we were hoping that it was he who was going to redeem Israel. He did redeem Israel. They needed spiritual redeeming. You and I need to be spiritually redeemed before we can be physically redeemed. They got it backwards. They wanted to be physically redeemed, and when that did not happen at that moment, and by the way, it didn't happen for probably almost 200 years later when Rome fell. We know 70 AD, 70 years after Christ's death, Titus marched into Jerusalem and destroyed the temple. So they had a long, long ways to go. Just now, the Jews are being called back to the Middle East. They've been scattered to the four corners of the earth, but they could not see with spiritual eyes. He was going to redeem Israel indeed. Besides, all this today is the third day since these things happened. Yes, and certain women of our company who arrived at the tomb early astonished us. When they did not find his body, they came saying that they had also seen a vision of angels who said he was alive. And certain of those who were with us went to the tomb and found it, just as the women had said, but him they did not see. I'll end with the scripture reading right there. Jesus drew near them. Jesus was walking with them. Jesus was on the dusty road of Emmaus with them. He was unchanged after his crucifixion, other than his scarred face and scarred body. But they did not know him. Like millions of people in America today, worldwide, that, but especially in America, they don't have a clue what Palm Sunday means. They don't have a clue what Easter really means. Oh, Easter, I saw a sign, 25,000 eggs being dropped at ABU. I mean, that's fine. I don't get freaked out. A lot of religious people, they get really freaked out over the things of the earth. I don't care. Well, don't you know that Easter egg represents fertility? Don't you know that it's ushering in spring? Ain't no big deal. But the whole world, that's what they see. They just see the goodies. They don't understand that they need to get their spiritual eyes open. Jesus drew near. Jesus was and is always near. He's near us today. He was near us yesterday. He'll be near us tomorrow. Jesus draws near to our inner consciousness. Second point, Jesus not only drew near, he went with them to the end of their journey. He said, I will be with you unto the ends of the earth. As he was with them, he is with us.
Amen.
Four levels of the Christian life must consist of the following. One, prayer is a duty or a necessity. Without it, the spiritual life will shrivel and die. You don't pray, your spiritual life will shrivel and die. Prayer is the expression of praise to God. It is a privilege and a duty to praise God. Three, prayer is intercession for others. That's what we did today. It's also a duty and a command to pray for our fellow brothers and sisters. We have to pray for them. And four, prayer for ourselves is a duty to yourself. We sometimes see more through our spiritual eyes than our physical eyes. Or we can if we want to. In this case, they didn't. Early tradition identifies Cleopas as the brother of Joseph, Mary's husband. Verses 19 to 21. While they still perceive Jesus as a prophet, their messianic hopes have been crushed by his death. We have the Muslims believe that today. They don't deny Jesus. They deny him as Messiah. They say he was one of many great prophets. They missed it. You think people aren't blind today? Their spiritual blindness came from failure to recognize that the scriptures foretold the necessity of the Messiah's suffering and dying. It's a good thing that he died for us. He didn't die for a new car. He didn't die for a new house. He didn't die to set some group of people free. He died for the sins of the world.
Amen.
Thank God he did. The manner in which Jesus broke the bread revealed his identity to them. You see that in verse 35. The perception of Jesus went beyond mere physical recognition. Now, keep going a little farther. Look at verse 35. Because I got it in. And they told him about the things that had happened on the road and how he was known to them in the breaking of bread. He was known to them in the breaking of bread. They finally got it. Their spirit, their physical eyes opened up and they begin to see Jesus in spiritual eyes. And then he goes on here and see the scriptures because I got to get right on this. Okay, look at, let me read on through. 36, now they said these things. Jesus himself stood in the midst of them and said to them, peace to you. I just prayed that to a sister this morning. Peace to you. But they were terrified and frightened and supposed that they had seen a spirit. And he said to them, why are you troubled? And why do you doubt? Why does doubt arise in your hearts? Mary prophesied about that this morning. Behold, my hands and my feet, that is, I myself, handle me and see, for a spirit does not have flesh and bones as you see I have. He had become a ghost. He had flesh and bones.
Yes.
When he said this, he showed them his hands and his feet. But while they still did not believe for joy and manifest and marvel, he said to them, can you give me food here? He had to prove it to them by eating. So they gave him a piece of broiled fish and some honeycomb, and he took it and he ate in their presence. Are we going to have food in heaven? Yes. No counters. Scripture is sometimes comprehended in the light of its fulfillment. Let me go on here. Then he said to them, thus it is written, and thus it is necessary for the Christ to suffer and to rise from the dead on the third day, and that repentance and remission of sin should be preached in his name, all nations beginning in Jerusalem, and you are witnesses of these things. Behold, I send the promise of my Father upon you, but tarry in the city of Jerusalem, until you are moved to power from up on high. I close with this. Many churches deny the baptism of the Holy Spirit. It is the direct fruit of Jesus that Jesus said to us. You get that when you shut down the Holy Spirit in the church, you really are shutting down the witness that Jesus really was who he said he was. I go away that another might come in my place. And after you receive him, show his power. In Acts, the second chapter talks about it. They were all filled with the Holy Ghost with the evidence of speaking in other tongues. Every time you hear somebody speak in tongues, they're saying Jesus did what he said he would do. And churches are saying you don't need that here. Get in the honeymoon. Get in the afterglow. Don't allow that in the public. Don't you understand that you deny the power of the Holy Spirit? You muffle, in a sense, the very death, burial, and resurrection of Jesus Christ.
Amen.
He said that will be direct proof of what I did.
Amen.
That's why it's vital and it's important. You're not in a Pentecostal church. You ought to be in a Pentecostal church.
Amen.
Every time they speak in tongues, They're saying Jesus is real.
Amen.
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 I got it again. My daughter.
Hear the sound, of the nations worshiping. Hear the sound.